Late last year, we met Ellen Nelson, a former Kiwi soldier helping Afghans escape the Taliban and resettle in New Zealand. Our story forced the government to step in and help, and ever since, a steady stream have made it here to safety. But now we find the government's refusing to grant visas to eligible Afghans who helped our soldiers. Why? Well, here's Mark Kreisel.
I struggle to sleep at night because these little faces are whirring through my head.
So what do these faces mean to you?
Quite a lot, actually.
This little girl here, baby Shireen, she's just striking, and this little face here just stuck in my mind.
For the past 8 months, Ellen Nelson has been on a mission to get Bibi and a whole list of others from Afghanistan to Aotearoa.
Some of the families that I'm going to see today, it's been more than 11 years since I saw them last.
100 people from that list are coming to an Auckland park to see her today.
She has saved not just our life, saved our children's life.
And one of those children...
I love Ellen.
...is 7-year-old Bibi Shireen.
I will hug Ellen.
To see her in the flesh, on New Zealand soil, safe, running at me to give me a hug was just, yeah, it was too much. it was a lot.
But not everyone on Ellen's list is safe. Families left behind, still hiding for their lives.
How worried are you still about their safety?
Oh, deeply worried. I won't sleep properly until everyone from this list is out.
So why won't our government let them in?
How did you feel when you heard about that?
Furious. Absolutely furious.
This is an emergency message to the...
Towards the end of last year, Sunday spoke to many of these people as they hid from the Taliban.
Our children are sick.
Their crime?
PTSD.
Working alongside Kiwi soldiers as they attempted to rebuild their war-torn country.
How close do you think the Taliban are to finding you?
Here, always we see the Taliban is across the roads.
Ellen Nelson worked with them as a captain in the New Zealand Army's provincial reconstruction team in Bamiyan.
They actually fundamentally kept us safe, and so New Zealand... we owe it to them to keep them safe.
New Zealand offered them safe haven, but rescue flights were halted in August last year after a suicide bombing at Kabul airport.
Okay, well,
Ellen and a team of volunteers were working around the clock trying to process paperwork for 40 families and keep them alive.
Calling MFAT, calling immigration, trying to find out what was going on with these visas, because without them, none of these people could have gotten out.
The New Zealand government had disengaged following the airport bombing. Finally, they responded.
I would like to believe that Ellen and the government is able to work together under these really challenging times.
When we spoke last time, how many of your families have managed to get out?
None. When we spoke, not a single person on our list was out of Afghanistan.
Taliban.
That was then.
Kiss me.
This is now. 8 months ago, it would have been too dangerous to show their faces. They're safe now.
It's good to see you again.
Okay.
Yeah.
It is a huge weight on my shoulders and also on our team. It's very heavy. But every time we get a family across a border, that load becomes just that little bit lighter.
Please, please, please take us to New Zealand.
Almost all the people on Ellen's list have managed to make it to New Zealand.
Oh, look at you!
We now have a process and we have pathways in place due to, you know, great collaboration between us volunteer advocates and the government. And I believe we're going to get more of these people here.
Afghanistan to Aotearoa, crossing the Afghan border to a third country armed with the proper paperwork and hopping on a plane to New Zealand.
It's not sort of cloak and daggers, it's just a big administrative task. There is absolutely risk every time we move someone across the border, and it's for those reasons and for the safety of future families that we try and evacuate that I just, sorry, I don't go into any details. And then kneeling down at the front, we got Cheeky over there in front of Abbas. In front of Abbas. You guys are close.
The men who worked for the Kiwis have escaped a Taliban death sentence.
How have they changed since you saw them all those years ago?
So the guys that were on my team, kind of not at all. You know, they look just like I remember them from 11 years ago. They're still cheeky and still just as fun as they used to be. So.
1, 2, 3.
Okay. These people call you a hero. Oh. Are you comfortable with that?
I did all this from the comfort and safety of my home. You know, I didn't risk my life to do this. I didn't do anything brave.
If you didn't do it, they might not be here.
Maybe. Oh, sorry.
So who's the hero here?
I think these families are. They've gone through this really traumatic experience and they are the heroes that have made their way to New Zealand and so thrilled to be a part of that.
For the Afghans here, they know how lucky they are. A chance at a better life for their children, especially their daughters.
We're going to be a team to help who are still in Afghanistan, and we'll try to get them out here.
This is Saraya. Her father worked as a carpenter with Kiwi troops. The family hid for 2 months in the mountains around Bamiyan after the Taliban took over.
All the things were getting worse day by day, and it made our lives so hard. We were so frightened.
Human rights, women's rights, the right to an education. Under the Taliban, girls can't attend high school or university.
The world that they want us to live in, that's dark, full of darkness.
For Marwa, too.
I feel so hopeless, depressed. There was no wish for me to live anymore because it was so hard.
You've been in touch with Marzia?
The 18-year-olds were schoolmates in Bamiyan. If they'd stayed, there was a good chance they'd be taken by Taliban fighters as brides.
With my friends, they thought that the woman should stay at home. They should obey their husbands.
That's not you, is it?
No. I don't want to be like that, and I'm not.
When I see these young girls who are, you know, sort of teenagers, very intelligent, articulate young women, the opportunities available to them here in New Zealand is just, you know, significantly greater than what it would have been had they not got here.
But these are the lucky ones.
I pray that the Taliban do not find me. If they do, they will kill me and my family.
When we come back, eligible Afghans left behind and refused a visa.
I missed the visa deadline as I wasn't hiring and I couldn't get my documents as it was too dangerous.
Deeply, deeply unfair. Please. Please, Prime Minister, remove this deadline.
Before they came to New Zealand.
I really like the waves.
Yeah, it's a very peaceful environment.
Yeah.
18-year-olds Marwa and Saraya had never before seen the ocean.
I've got many goals, many dreams. Do I want to do them here?
Now I feel the freedom that I have because I can do anything that I want.
Their horizons now seem infinite.
I want to learn driving. I want to learn bike riding. I want to learn cricket, playing guitar.
But most of all, they want to go back to school.
I want to be a lawyer and to be the best version of myself that I can be.
I want to be a doctor.
Why?
Because now when I see that I've got the opportunity and the chance, so of course I have got that goal.
School, jobs, homes, learning English online.
Yes, Marwa.
I wanted to ask that to climb means to walk?
Yeah, that's right.
A climb that Marwa, Saraya and their families are prepared to do so they can integrate into New Zealand society.
They are going to be amazing contributors to New Zealand society. They are so grateful to be here in New Zealand. This is sort of a golden opportunity for them. They know that they've won the lottery.
Every lottery has winners. It also has losers. This is one of them.
Since Taliban came to power, I didn't have a job, no money, and I have to hide myself and my family just to survive.
How many times have you had to move over the past month?
I'm moving weekly because I do not want Taliban to find me.
We can't show Feroz's face. His life now in danger because of a bureaucratic deadline.
I served with the New Zealand Defence Force. My life and my family lives are at risk because the Taliban can track our cell phones.
Our team are aware of probably around 20 or 30 families that are in that situation. They are absolutely eligible. They meet the eligibility criteria. They just missed the deadline because they were in hiding.
Remember, the government promised to rescue those Afghans who'd worked alongside the Kiwi soldiers.
And it will be difficult and it may take longer, but we are not giving up.
Stay there!
But that only applies to those who could get a visa before August 25th last year.
We're talking a 9-day window is all that people had to apply for a visa. And we know of families that missed that short window because they were literally hiding in the mountains to avoid being killed.
Have you explained to them you couldn't make the August the 25th deadline?
Yes. I have told them and explained, but all they say is that I have missed the deadline and they do not provide me with a specific answer or solution.
The consequences for those left behind are deadly serious. International aid to Afghanistan has dried up and people are starving.
What is that?
You're barely surviving.
We are seeing pictures and hearing stories out of Afghanistan of famine, of people starving. How bad is the situation?
There are reports of families that have to sell their children to survive. And it's hard for me because I do not have any money and I'm very worried about my children.
There's also a growing sense of menace and terror on the streets for those left behind. There's been interrogations and beatings by the Taliban and in one case, death.
The guard that was killed, his name was Murad. So he was one of those people that missed that deadline. Our team, we tried to apply for visas for his widow and his children, and we have not succeeded in getting them.
How did you feel when you heard about that?
Furious. Absolutely furious. It makes no sense to have that cut-off date. Therefore, we are excluding eligible people, which is the complete opposite of what the Prime Minister committed to doing.
How hard have you tried?
We've tried writing to the ministers. We're trying every avenue we can to remove this ridiculous cut-off date, which is excluding eligible people.
Have they responded to you?
No.
You've heard nothing?
No.
Do you have any idea why this date exists?
No idea.
The Minister of Immigration, Chris Farfoy, declined our many requests for an interview, but sent us instead a statement. We wanted to know why the cut-off date was so immovable, especially when there are eligible Afghans who worked with the New Zealand forces who are in serious danger. Nothing in this two-page statement answers that question. Nothing in here gives any hope to those left behind.
Meanwhile, Afghans with no Kiwi connection are being let in after the deadline, including Sawar Danish, a former Afghan vice president granted a visa under humanitarian grounds and arrived here around Christmas with 13 other family members.
I don't sort of begrudge that issuing of visa, but what I do take from it is that it just shows you that visas can be issued if politicians want them to be. That to me is deeply unfair and not okay.
Are you missing her?
Yep.
Both Marwa and Soraya know people left behind.
I left behind my sister, my oldest sister, the one who I really loved.
I hope that he could get the visa.
Seven of my family members, they are left back in Afghanistan. One of my brother, yeah, he is in hiding, but the others are still in Bamyan.
They gave their lives to help the New Zealand Defence Force do their job and helped protect us and enable us to do this task. And so it's just the right thing to do to now bring these people to safety, to New Zealand.
Will New Zealand fulfil its obligation if this date doesn't change?
No, New Zealand will fulfil its obligations once we get all eligible people to New Zealand.
Bibi, Marwa, Soraya can now live their lives in a peaceful country. New Zealand has given to them, and they want to give back.
I want to be a good and active New Zealander, living a peaceful and a good life.
But they will never forget where they came from.
I want to see Afghan people in peace and smiles on their faces.
1, 2, 3, ready?
Yeah.
Excellent.
I'm going to do this.
Because they both know it's not how you fall, it's how you help your mate get back up again.
Do you think you'll be able to smile again?
Yes.
Well, Soraya has begun studying and her sister arrived in New Zealand this weekend. Marwa's family is soon to move into a home. Meanwhile, her brother's still in hiding somewhere in Afghanistan.